All right, got to go now. Now, after a significant Philistine victory over Israel at Aphek in 1 Samuel 4, which seems to have included the destruction of the tabernacle at Shiloh, and you can see that in Jeremiah 7, 12 to 15, and Psalm 78, 60. After that defeat, the people of Israel, they demanded a king, and the first Israelite king, King Saul, he was anointed by the prophet Samuel. You see that in 1 Samuel chapter 10, around 1051 B.C. I'm trying to keep the chronology in your head there. He's probably 30 to 40 years old at that time. And then after Saul is anointed king, he promptly defeated the Ammonites who were attacking Jabesh-Gilead. And you see Jabesh-Gilead there. They're attacking them. He comes up. He rescues them. And then that victory was followed by this very elaborate or very public affirmation at Gilgal. You see the arrow going down from Jabesh-Gilead to Gilgal. A public affirmation of Saul's kingship. And then later, and Anthony had gone over some of this, but I just got to set where we are. Later in 1 Samuel 13, when Saul was doing battle with the Philistines, he violated the Lord's command, you recall, by offering the burnt offering when he was supposed to be waiting for Samuel. So he violates the Lord's command there when he's waiting for Samuel to arrive, and he did that because he thought he needed to do it because his troops were abandoning him. And he sees the troops leaving, and he goes, look, I have to do something. And he offers the burnt offering, and as soon as he does, Samuel comes up and says, that wasn't good. So he does that, though, but that was what was motivating, and Samuel rebuked him and told him in 1 Samuel 13 that his kingdom would not continue, meaning that he would have no dynasty. You see, in 13, what's at stake is the dynasty, that his descendants would not follow him on the throne. That's what a dynasty is, where your family line continues on the throne. He says in 1 Samuel 13 that you're not going to have a dynasty. And then in 1 Samuel 15, God rejected Saul. Not just his descendants, he rejected Saul from being king because Saul disobeyed him by keeping the sheep and oxen from the defeated Amalekites and sparing their king from the death penalty. You remember, so now Saul as king is rejected. The dynasty's taken at 13. The kingship is taken from him. So the die's cast at that point. Saul was finished as king. The die's cast there. Now, though he would continue for a number of years as the de facto king, in fact, his reign goes 40 years. His total reign of Saul is 40 years. And you can see that in Acts chapter 13, verse 21. Though he continued as the de facto king for a number of years, he was removed as the ruler through a violent death in 1011 BC. Philistine archers, they wounded him so severely that he fell on his sword deliberately. That was when his armor bearer wouldn't finish him off. But he fell on his sword deliberately in the hope of accelerating his death so as to avoid being brutalized by the approaching Philistines. He sees I'm mortally wounded, and I don't want to be around for these guys to, you know, do stuff to me. So he says, kill me. The guy says, I'm not about to kill you. And so then he falls on his own sword. And so this is in, you see that? He's killed. This is around 1011. He's removed as king through this violent death. And in Chronicles, 1 Chronicles chapter 10, verse 13, it says, so Saul died for his breach of faith. He broke faith with the Lord in that he did not keep the commandment of the Lord and also consulted a medium seeking guidance. I'll talk about that in just a second in a little more detail. But that seeking the medium, I want you to see that this violent death that Saul suffered, this was in fact the taking of the kingship from him, even though it was years later. In other words, he didn't live out a long life as king. He had 40 years of reign, but he was still killed violently. And that was God's removal of him from the kingship, speaking through the medium at Endor, or the witch at Endor. In 1 Samuel chapter 28, 17 and 18, Samuel made clear that Saul's imminent death, the death that he and his sons were going to experience the next day, that was the removal of his kingship that had been promised in 1 Samuel 15 for his sparing of the Amalekites. So here's, this is Saul, where we are with Saul. Now David was born in Bethlehem around 1041 BC. We know that because he comes to the throne in 1011 and he's at age 30 when he comes to the throne. You see that in 2 Samuel 5:4. But he's born in Bethlehem around 1041. So Saul had already been ruling as king for some 10 years when David is born. He's the youngest of Jesse's 8 sons. And there's an interesting text in 1 Chronicles chapter 2, verse 13 that speaks of him as the seventh of 7 sons. Well, he's the youngest of, he's the 8th of 8 sons, or he's the 7th of 7 sons. Well, I guess it depends on how you reckon it, because if one of Jesse's sons died without children, you could skip him. It's like, I had a brother who died. I'm the youngest. You can tell me I'm the youngest of 4 sons. Or depending on the context, I'll tell you I'm the youngest of 3 sons. Well, that's the idea. So after this thing in 1 Samuel 16, apparently one of his sons had died, so he's counted either the 7th of 7 or the 8th of 8. Just depends on how you want to reckon that. Okay, that's just for those who are bothered by such things. All right, after the prophet Samuel, after he tells Saul that God had taken the kingship from him, God instructs Samuel to go to Bethlehem to anoint the next king. As the next king, go there and anoint one of the sons of Jesse. So Saul has disobeyed. God has taken the kingship from him, though he's going to continue as de facto king for a while. But he says, he tells the prophet, he says, you go and anoint one of the sons of Jesse as the next king. And when Samuel saw Eliab, who's Jesse's oldest son, he assumes from his appearance that that's the one he's going to anoint, because this is apparently an impressive fellow, something like my brother John. You know, impressive looking guy. And he says, surely this is the one that the Lord intends for me to anoint. But in that famous text, God says to Samuel, he says, do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I've rejected him. For the Lord sees not as man sees. Man looks on the outward appearance, and don't we? You see, we're always judging by that kind of stuff. He says, but the Lord looks on the heart. You see, so yes, I see you're impressed by Eliab, and you naturally think that's the one you're going to... No. I'm looking somewhere else, okay? So he tells him that. Now, after Jesse's 7 older sons come before Samuel and the Lord doesn't choose any of them, Samuel asks, he says, are all your sons here? He said, well, you know, no, there's one. The guy who's out watching the sheep, he's not here, my youngest. The youngest isn't here. So Samuel says, will you go and send for him? So they wait. David arrives, and then God tells Samuel that David is the one. And Samuel anoints him with oil in the midst of his brothers. And when he did so, the text says in 1 Samuel 16:13, the Spirit of the Lord rushed upon David. The Spirit of the Lord rushed upon David from that day forward. So something's going on. When the Lord anoints David as king, the Spirit rushes on him. Now, whatever you want to take from that day forward, something is being done in David's life. God has selected him, and the Spirit has rushed on David. So something is being done there. Now, though David's described in 1 Samuel 16:12 as handsome and ruddy looking, which means he has a healthy looking glow, a healthy complexion. He's described that way. God has already made clear that his focus is where? The heart. David is handsome, in fact. Again, like my brother, he's a looker. You see, but God's focus is not on the external. God's focus is on the heart, which he's already made clear. And Samuel, in fact, had earlier said to King Saul, but now your kingdom will not endure. The Lord has sought out a man after his own heart and appointed him leader of his people because you have not kept the Lord's command. So there's something about David and his heart and his commitment, and you'll see that. Well, you know the story of David. But there's something there. So that's what God is looking on. Now, David, at this point, he's old enough. When Samuel comes to anoint the sons of Jesse, David is old enough to tend the flocks on his own because he's out tending the flocks and all of his brothers are there. So he's old enough to do that, but he's quite young. Okay, quite young. I know that because he's still described as a youth sometime later when he confronts Goliath. So David at this time of his anointing is quite young. Maybe he's 12 to 14. He's old enough to be able to tend the sheep on his own, but still young. So you say, well, what would, all right, let's say maybe 12 to 14. That would be a good guess. That he's out there big enough, able enough to tend the sheep when he's anointed. And maybe he's 15 to 19 years old when he meets Goliath. That would still be a youth. So 12 to 14 when he's anointed, maybe 15 to 19 when he meets Goliath. And if that's correct, then that would put his anointing around 1028 BC. Okay, that's going to be close to when David is anointed king. You remember, we have Saul comes to the throne 1051. David's anointed 1028. So Saul's been reigning for some 23 years at that time. Now the judgment on Saul's disobedience that's reflected in the anointing of David as the next king, that's part of the judgment on Saul's disobedience that's reflected there. That judgment continued with the departure of God's Spirit from Saul. You see that very text where it says the Spirit rushed on David when he's anointed, then what happens? The Spirit's taken from Saul. So this is the judgment. It's not only that David is anointed as the next king, God's Spirit is taken from Saul, and he's inflicted with some kind of mental torment, unspecified. People say, well, it's depression, whatever it is, he's inflicted with some kind of mental torment. And that seems to be part of God's plan to acquaint David with life in the royal court in preparation for the role that David is going to fill in life. That's how it looks to me, is that this is part of God's plan to acquaint David with life in the royal court. Well, how's that connected? Well, David was known to be skilled in playing a stringed instrument called a lyre. Okay, so he's known to be somebody who this guy can play. And so he's known to be that way, and so he was sought out by Saul's servants as a kind of therapist to soothe Saul's distress when the Spirit afflicted Saul. So the Spirit is afflicting Saul with whatever this mental distress is. David is somebody who's a skilled musician. The idea is that we think that this playing may be beneficial and therapeutic for Saul, so we'll go get David and have him play when Saul's in a mess. And we're hoping that that will help him out. And David, at that time, he had gone back. He was anointed, but he'd gone back to his duties of shepherding. And you can see that in 1 Samuel 16:19. Now, I have to say as a footnote, I always have footnotes, at least in my mind if I don't name them to you. But in 1 Samuel 16:18, when the servant describes David as a man of war, if I'm understanding what's going on correctly, that is an embellished characterization based on David's family being known to produce men of war. David's not a man of war yet. Okay? He even says man of valor. Well, he may be known as a man of valor based on some of the things he'd done as a shepherd. But when he says man of war, I think that's more of an idea that Jesse's family, they're known to produce men of war, and that's kind of an optimistic or embellished characterization when I'm saying, hey, I know this guy who can really play. By the way, he's this, man of war. Okay, so if I'm reading that right, he's not literally a man of war. Not yet. Now, David entered Saul's service, and it served God's purpose, you see, to have the Spirit cease tormenting Saul when David played. I don't think you jump to say, well, this is a medical thing. You see me play music. I think this is Spirit-induced, and it's part of God's plan to bring David into the court, and it's also part of God's plan that when David prays, the Spirit ceases tormenting Saul. So he plays, and wow, this is good. This is really effective. This is working. And so Saul loved David. And I think that's part of what God is doing in ingratiating David with the people of Israel. That he's not an enemy of Saul. Saul loved David. And part of how that was generated was that the Spirit freed Saul from the torment when David would play. So he loved David, and David became his armor bearer. That's somebody who carried extra weapons for him. So he comes there. Now in the next scene, we go into 1 Samuel chapter 17. David's back in Bethlehem. He's back in Bethlehem tending Jesse's sheep. Something apparently happened, the way I see this. Something apparently happened that led to David's return, but we're not told anything about it. Well, maybe Saul, maybe he felt well enough You know, he felt like things were going well enough, as may be suggested, in fact, by 1 Samuel 16:23, that the spirit, the distress and stuff had left him. So maybe he's thinking, okay, I'm feeling really good. Maybe he was feeling he was much improved and thought he was well enough that he no longer considered David's musical services necessary. He'd like to have David around, but he no longer felt that those services were necessary. Well, that would then make him more amenable to returning David should Jesse request that he do so. And maybe something had happened to Jesse's family, like they needed David's services. Maybe it was financial. You're not told. And that's the way the Bible is. You say, well, why don't you tell? Well, you know, God's right in the Bible. You can ask him later. But we go to 17. He's back there. I think it's reasonable to see how that could have happened. He winds up being back there. And so maybe there was something, as I say, maybe there was some kind of situation that Jesse had requested and Saul was doing well enough now. He said, okay, you know, he can go. Because if the king felt he really needed him, had to have him, he wouldn't let him go. So maybe that's part of what's going on. Now, some 3 to 5 years after David left King Saul's court and returned to shepherding. Okay, now I say some 3 to 5 years later because David, he's still a youth. Okay, when this event transpires, so I can't stretch it out too long. If he's 12 to 14 now, let's go 3 to 5 years later, maybe 15 to 19. But there's been some time that has elapsed. Some 3 to 5 years later, after he'd left Saul's court and returned to shepherding, you have the Philistines and the Israelites, they're squared off. And the Philistines were somebody who, you know, warred with Israel a lot. And they're squared off in the valley of Elah near Azekah. And I suspect it was during those years of shepherding, by the way, that David had killed both lions and bears in defense of his sheep, as he says in 1 Samuel chapter 17, 34 to 36. And you remember the Spirit of the Lord had rushed on him. Right, had rushed on him from that time forward. You say, well, how can anybody wind up killing a bear and a lion? Well, he has the Spirit of God, and God is preparing him for something. And so, you know, I wouldn't want to be facing a lion or a bear. I look at those things, I say, that thing kill me with just looking at me. But here was something, see, that God's Spirit had rushed on him. So you think that if you're confronted with one of these just crazed bears, lions showing you his teeth, and you kill that thing, well, that's going to say there's something at work here. There is a power at work in my life, and I think that's what God was doing with him. Well, David's three oldest brothers, they're in Saul's army. That's part of this idea that Jesse's family is a family that produces men of war. And so his three older brothers, they are in Saul's army, and Jesse, he sends David to them to deliver some food. So there you've got the Israelites and the Philistines squared off here, and Jesse says, listen, David, run out there. So apparently it wasn't set up the way our military is. We got all this food and everything. You know, it might be helpful to have your family, although we still send care packages, right? I mean, we do that. So if your family's close enough, you're going to say, hey, I know they're getting some food, but I really want them to eat well. So he sends David to drop off some of this stuff. And while he's there, David goes up to the front lines and he sees Goliath, this psychotic giant. And you got to picture this. You know, I'm thinking like some of those old Rocky movies, the way they had Hulk Hogan for it. The guy looked like he was a mountain. Well, you got to think, here's this psychotic giant. Okay, and I'm not talking about one of these freaks like a beanpole or something. This guy's just wild looking in terms of strong, big. Just an absolute psycho. And he steps out from the Philistine side and he shouts his usual defiance of Israel. Basically comes out and says, you're all punks. There's not one of you who will dare come down here and face me. Oh, Israel, Israel, God, God, you're nothing but punks and cowards. And none of you can fight. Come down here and fight. Pick any one of you. Come down here and fight. That's right. Run. Run. All right, so this is what he's doing. Humiliating, insulting God and his people. And they're all afraid of him. Absolutely terrified of him. The Israelites, they run from Goliath in fear. And David, when he's still a teenager, he saw this as a disgrace on Israel. And he says, who's this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God? You know, like running. He said, who is this guy? They're thinking, look at him. They said they should defy the armies of the living God. What, are you crazy? Well, this got back to Saul, and Saul sends for David. When David tells Saul that he'd fight Goliath, he says, you're not able to go out against this Philistine and fight him. He says, you're but a youth, and he's been a fighting man from his youth. You're a rookie. You're somebody who's just coming into your time. You're a kid. This guy is a warring psycho who has proven himself in battle from his youth. This guy knows how to kill people. He knows how to take people apart. That's why he's their champion. He's not simply a soldier. He is a champion who's put out in front to call out people. And by the way, people say, well, the description of Goliath's armor and stuff is anachronistic. Well, he's not a typical soldier. He's a champion. Okay? He's a champion. So that he would be dressed differently should bother no one. But it bothers people who are always attacking the Bible. It doesn't bother me. Okay, but he's out there and he's shouting this defiance. And David tells Saul, he said he protected his sheep from the lion and the bear. And he says, the Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine. That's what I'm telling you about. See, when he confronted those animals that had taken his sheep or were threatening his sheep, and he was able by the power of God to defeat those, he knows that God can overcome tremendous odds. What I see with my eyes isn't the key. What I trust God for is what matters. And he says, the same God who delivered me from the lion and the bear will give me victory over this Philistine. I don't care how big he is. I don't care how big his teeth are. That he will give me the victory. Now you talk about faith. Now David goes out against Goliath with only a sling and five smooth stones. And when Goliath sees that he's only a youth, he's insulted. You know, here he is. Look, he says, look, I'm a warrior. Think of these guys like Klingons from Star Trek. Okay? I'm a warrior. And you send a kid out to me? This is insulting to me that you think so little of my military might that you send a punk out here. So he's insulted. And he's enraged by it. It was disrespectful to him to send somebody out there like that. And he tells David, he says, come here and I'll give your flesh to the birds of the air and the beasts of the field. And David responds to him. Then David said to the Philistine, now you picture this. This is a teenager facing this warrior psycho. And he says, you come to me with a sword and with a spear and with a javelin. That's pretty intimidating. Because I imagine that dude could throw that thing. But he says, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will deliver you into my hands, and I will strike you down and cut off your head. And I'll give the dead bodies of the host of the Philistines this day to the birds of the air and to the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel, and that all this assembly may know that the Lord saves not with sword and spear, for the battle is the Lord's. And he will give you into our hand. Now, this is a teenage boy in that circumstance saying that. David had a heart of faith. You see, God looks on the heart. Now, you look at this guy. You look at the heart of faith that he has. You see, in chapter 17, verse 55 to 58, they indicate that Saul had forgotten who David's father was. And people make a lot about that and say, that can't happen. That's impossible. But it doesn't strike me as impossible, perhaps because of the number of years that elapsed. The multitude of people in the royal court. I mean, it's like, come on, you know. is it incomprehensible that somebody could forget who somebody's father was? Especially given the mental problems he'd been experiencing. Which we don't really know what they are. But in any event, from 1755 to 58, he isn't aware of who David's father is. And he wants to know, he needs to know, he's interested in that information because he'd promised his daughter to the person who defeated Goliath, and he'd also promised tax breaks for that person's father. So he wants to know, where's the family of this guy? I want to be sure about this because I'm going to give tax breaks to the father. That's in 1725. Well, after this, David and Saul's son, Jonathan, who's significantly older than David, But after this, after David's victory, you have here, David winds up with this great victory, precisely what he said happens. You know the story. And after that great victory, David and Jonathan become devoted friends. Saul again brings David into the royal court. You see that in 18:2. But when people begin praising David more than Saul, you know, they say that Saul killed his thousands, but David is 10,000. He says, that's not good. I'm the top dog, and they're all praising this dude. And so that wasn't good. And so he begins to be jealous of David. And during one of these spirit-induced bouts of mental torment, David's playing the lyre, and Saul twice tries to kill him with a spear. Now you can see David's sister. David may think, well, that's just the mental torment, you see. That's really not him after me. That's just like a psychotic episode. But David finally catches on eventually that, no, that's not really what it is. It's not simply some kind of aberration brought on by his mental distress. He's trying to kill me. He's bent on killing me. So that dawns on David. But here Saul tries to kill him. He tries to kill him twice with a spear. And so Saul feared David, it says, because he knew the Lord was with him. So he made him a commander of 1,000 troops to keep David away from him. I don't know if he's afraid that David's going to kill him, because he sees David rising. And this is how, you know, there's an awful lot of intrigue in these ancient courts. And so he says, I'm going to have him, I'll make him commander of 1,000, keep him away from me. But David had great success in that role. And what happens? He just becomes more popular. So Saul then plots to have David killed. And he plots to have him killed by naming as the bride price for his daughter Michal. He says, all right, no, I'll give her to you. You know, that I told you, I'll give her to you. After the one daughter, David says, no, who am I to marry the king's daughter? Then Michal comes. He says, yes, you can have her, but only thing I'm going to demand from you for bride price is 100 Philistine foreskins. Okay, this means I got to kill 100 Philistines. Then I circumcise them post-mortem, and then I bring you the foreskins. Well, what's the plot? The plot is he'll get killed in the process. You see, if I say you do that, and David says, okay, I didn't have money, I can't become the king's, you know, son-in-law, I don't have any money. So he says, no, you don't need money. Just go bring me 100 Philistine foreskins. All right, so the plot is, he says, David's going to go out there, and David's going to get killed in the attempt to collect them. But what happens? David brings him 200. He brings him 200. Saul gave Michal to David as a wife, but he was now even more opposed to David. See, because David is growing larger in popularity, larger in might, larger, you can see, in military prowess. This guy's dangerous if you're the king sitting on here and you think he's your enemy. So now Saul instructed Jonathan and his servants to kill David. And at Jonathan's request, David goes into hiding, and then he returned when Jonathan seemed to have smoothed things out and talked Saul out of harming David. So Jonathan tells David, you take off, I'll see if I can patch things up over here, and then I'll come back. So he returns, but that didn't last long, because Saul again tried to pin David to the wall with a spear. And I think the light bulb's going off now, that I see that this is something deeper than just a momentary mental lapse because of whatever's going on with his, you know, the mental torment. He tries to kill him again with a spear, and David then flees into the night, and his wife Michal helps him in that escape. So he then takes off, and David, he flees to the prophet Samuel at Ramah, which is near Gibeah, and this is the best map I could see there. He flees to Samuel, and it goes to Ramah, and when Saul sent men to capture him there, he hears, okay, David's up there. So Saul sends detachments to go capture David and bring him back. But when he does that, the Spirit of the Lord falls on them. Falls on each of the detachments and ultimately on Saul himself, which prevents them from achieving their goal. Because when the Spirit rushes on them, what are they doing? They just start prophesying. Saul even winds up naked. So all of this thought about going and get David is gone by the Spirit of God. But they were going to get him. And this is God, the Spirit falls on them, they prophesy, and God said, not today, guys. I know you may think you got the drop on David, but you don't quite understand that David is my man. And no, that's not going to happen. So this is what happens when they go up there and try to get him there. Now David then flees from Ramah. He flees from Ramah, and he manages to meet Jonathan privately. And Jonathan tells him he's going to try to work out a safe return. And I got to skip a little bit of the story here, but this ultimately, he says, I'm going to try to work this out. That doesn't work. So David and Jonathan have to part company there for good. But Jonathan, you know, they're devoted to each other, covenant buddies. And he says, I'm going to try to work this out. That time, that's a no-go. So they have to part company. Now, while on the run, David told Ahimelech, who's the priest in a town called Nob, he tells Ahimelech that he's on a secret mission from King Saul. Ahimelech says, okay, in that case, I'll give you some bread to eat, and you can have Goliath's sword. He gives him some of the holy bread, something to eat, and he says, you can also have Goliath's sword. Now, Saul's chief herdsman, a guy named Doeg the Edomite, he's there and he spots this. He sees Ahimelech giving David food and a sword. Okay, so that's going to come back up. Now, David flees from Nob. He runs to the Philistine city. He goes there of Gath. But when the servants of Achish, king of Gath, when they reminded him, that, look, David is somebody who's a renowned military man in Israel. You know, this just isn't some dude just wandered. This is David, about whom they say he killed tens of thousands. And so when they start this story, David gets worried because he says, this could turn out poorly for me. And so what David does, he feigns mental illness. He starts scratching at the doors of the gate and drooling spit into his beard. And so when they bring him before the king goes, hey man, you think I don't have enough crazy people around here? You got to bring me this guy. And so he said, out. I don't need another nut in my kingdom. So he sends him away. Now David then goes to the cave of Adullam, where some 400 debtors and fugitives and political malcontents, it's quite a gang, they gather around David and he becomes their commander. And then he went to Mizpah of Moab, and he delivers his parents there in the protection of the king of Moab. Because David realizes, you know, this is tough stuff. And in our world, the families of people don't really turn out too well. You're an enemy, they'll go kill you and all your family. And so he takes his parents over into the protection of the king of Moab. And that's very interesting. But you'll recall, you know, that out of our study of Ruth, that David had roots where? He had roots in Moab. That's where Ruth is from, right? She's a Moabite. And so he takes him over there. But beyond that, Saul had already made war on Moab. So they probably figured that it is politically wise to keep this rift alive to weaken Israel. Okay, so they would have some self-interest in it too. But anyway, he drops his parents off there. Now, Paul summoned all the priests of Nob. You remember Ahimelech, who'd given the bread and the sword. He summons all the priests of Nob when he hears from Doeg the Edomite. And he has Doeg slaughter the priests. Slaughter the priests. Now he has him do that, by the way, when his guard refused to do so. He says, kill the priests. And they said, we can't do that. And you see, it was so unusual that Saul, there's no record of Saul taking retribution against the guards for refusing what he did. I think he understood that he was asking for something that was absurd. And they wouldn't do that. But he tells Doeg the Edomite, you do it, and he kills him. So he kills the priest there, and only Abiathar escaped, and he goes to David. And while on the run, David's band, with assurances from the Lord, they defeated the Philistines who were attacking the town of Keilah. You see there on the map. So he comes and he defeats the Philistines who were attacking that. The Lord had assured him that he'd give him the victory. And when Saul hears that David's down in Keilah, he says, okay, we got him. Let's go attack him there in Keilah, and we'll have him pinned in, you know, surrounded and trapped in the city. So David asked the Lord, he says, are the people of Keilah, are they going to dime me? Are they going to turn me over to Saul? After all, I just rescued their town, you know, so I figured they'd stand with me, my band and all of them, and we could make this a really rough thing. The Lord tells him, they're going to turn you over. They're going to turn you over. So, all right, so they tell him that. So David then goes on the run. Saul pursues David and his band throughout the countryside. And at one point, Saul goes into a cave to go to the bathroom. But David and his men are hiding there, so Saul takes his robe off and tosses it over there. He's going to the bathroom. David creeps up very stealthily, cuts off the corner of his robe. Saul goes out of the cave, and then David comes out and says, "Hey, you see this? I could have killed you. You didn't even know I was in there. The fact I didn't kill you shows that I'm not your enemy. If I was your enemy, you'd be dead." Saul says, good point. Okay, so Saul says, good point. He gives up the hunt, and he goes home. 1 Samuel chapter 25, Samuel dies. And then in that chapter, David is spared from taking revenge on an insulting and ungrateful man named Nabal. He's spared from taking revenge by the wisdom and the tact of Nabal's wife, Abigail. This clown is out here treating David's men like they're a joke, insulting them. And so David, you know, that's what I tell you. This is not a place where you treat people like that, especially somebody like David. And so David is coming, but I don't think this was right of David. But David was coming to avenge his honor and the honor of his men by killing all those people. And so Abigail hears about this and says, "This guy is a clown. I got to go out and do something." And she goes out and she, David brings all kinds of food. David, you know, they put it on me. Put it on me. All right, David says, okay. Okay. So he's spared of that. And it's noted in 25:44, just in passing, that Saul had given David's wife Michal to a man named Palti, and that'll come up later. Okay, so now Saul once again is moved to pursue David. You say, how does this happen? David comes out and he says, "Listen, I'm not your enemy." He says, "Okay, I get it. All right, I'll go." But you have to understand the pressures. First, I don't know how stable he is mentally. But besides that, you have all these pressures of people coming to you saying, "What? What are you doing? David is after your throne. I've got the word from different people." So he's got people who are telling him, "You're being played as a fool." All right, so I don't know all that goes into this, but to have a politician be wishy-washy shouldn't shock anybody. Right? I mean, that shouldn't shock anybody. But in any event, here he goes. After he says, "Okay, I'm out," the next thing you know, he's back. Okay? So he's once again, he's pursuing David. And once again, David spares Saul's life. David and Abishai, they creep into Saul's camp, aided, by the way, by a deep sleep that the Lord had brought on the people. You say, how can these trained people not hear that? Well, the Lord brought a deep sleep on them. That's how. And so they creep in there, and they take the spear in the jar of water that's next to Saul's head, and then they go up to the top of a hill, and they shout down. They say, "Hey, we could have killed you, but we didn't." Same idea as the cutting of the robe in the cave. We had the drop on you. You were right there. I could have killed you, and I did not. That ought to tell you something. Okay, so once again, Saul's again moved to call off his pursuit of David. But now David understands that any respite he has from Saul's pursuit is going to be temporary. You see, he realizes that Saul, at some deep level that is always able to be turned, is intent on killing him. Boo. Okay. All right, he's intent on killing him. So David recognizes this now. And so he and his 600 men, they went to Achish ben Maok, king of Gath, as seeming deserters. Now this is I think it's a different Achish, by the way. Achish, there's evidence that Achish is like a title, like Pharaoh, and not a personal name. So here you have Achish ben Maok, and just like you would have Pharaoh, king of Egypt, Pharaoh Necho, personal name, king of Egypt. Well, here Achish seems to function the same way. So this isn't necessarily the same king he went before and drooled in front of. Okay? But in any event, he goes to Achish ben Maok, and he goes there, and they go as seeming deserters. And when Saul learns that, okay, he's over in Gath in the Philistine turf, he's history. He will never again be able to destroy me from inside because he's cast his lot with our enemies. Now, maybe I'll meet him in battle, but that's one thing. I'll meet anybody in battle. But he's not going to be from inside and turning the people of Israel against me and having them follow him because he's now a deserter. Okay, so Saul then, with that move, leaves him alone. David's given the town of Ziklag, and you can see down there, I don't know how sure they are about the location, but it seems to be on the frontier of Philistia. He's given that town, and from there he makes raids on the Amalekites. He makes raids there, the Geshurites and the Gerzites, and he'd bring the spoil back to the king of Gath, but he'd always tell him, I got it from raids on Judah. And why does he do that? Because that then the guy says, well, they're going to hate him. See, he's really become a stench in their nostrils, is the phrase. Going to hate them. So he's reinforcing this idea that he's got nothing to do with them. So this is what he would wind up doing. Now the Philistines, here they gathered at Shunem for this war against Israel. And Israel's forces they're gathered with Saul at Gilboa. And Saul's afraid, and the Lord's not answering any of his inquiries. Saul's really worried about this. He's upset. So he disguises himself and he goes to this woman at Endor who's believed to be able to consult the dead. Consulting the dead is not something we're to do. Okay? We don't communicate with the dead. And so he winds up saying, listen, I want to go to this medium, this witch, who is thought to have this power to communicate with dead people. And God gives this woman a vision. God gives her a vision of Samuel rising up from the ground. And when she describes that vision to Saul, Saul knew it was Samuel. He bows in homage, and Samuel tells him, look, you and your sons are going to be here with me tomorrow. It means you're going to be dead. Okay? You and your sons are going to be killed. You're going to be defeated. And all Israel is going to be defeated by the Philistines. And this was the promised removal. He makes clear this was the promised removal from him of the kingship as punishment for the disobedience of sparing the Amalekites in 1 Samuel 15. All right, now prior to moving to their staging area of Aphek, the Philistines, they tell David's with them, and he says, no, let me go. And Achish says, yeah, you've been a good guy. You can come with us. But prior to going there, the commanders tell David, they say to Achish, look, you're being a moron. You can't let David come because when the fighting gets thick, he's going to turn on us and he's going to get back in their good graces. You got to be crazy. So he sends David back. So David comes back so he doesn't fight against Israel. But the Philistines continue without David. And then they have this battle here. They did indeed rout Israel that day. The day after Samuel had said through that message of the medium, and Saul and his three sons, Jonathan, Abinadab, and Malchishua, they're killed on Mount Gilboa. And as I said earlier, the archers had mortally wounded Saul, and then he falls on his own sword when his armor bearer won't kill him. Well, David, he returns to Ziklag before that battle's gone. They said he can't come with us. He goes back to Ziklag, and when he gets back there, he finds out that, look, the Amalekites had burned the town and taken the people. So David inquires of the Lord. The Lord says, go pursue them. You'll win. David and his men, they go down there after them, and they pursue the Amalekites. They destroy them. They recover their people and their possessions, and they also took spoil from the Amalekites, and part of it they gave to towns of Judah. See, David's not stupid. He gave, and he says, he gives spoil to these towns of Judah, and he says, here's a present for you from the spoil of the enemies of the Lord. Okay, so he's you got to stick with me, because I got to get finished. Okay, all right, I'll try to be fast. Hang with me for just give me another 2 minutes, okay? On the third day, David comes back. Third day after he comes back from pursuing the Amalekites who destroyed Ziklag, so he comes down before the battle at Mount Gilboa. He chases the Amalekites, defeats them, comes back. The third day after he's back in Ziklag after that, here comes an Amalekite who says, listen, I just came from the battle and I'm telling you, Saul is defeated, Israel's defeated, Saul and his three sons are dead. David says, that's very good. How do you know that? And this guy says, well, I got his crown and his armband for one, but I stumbled on him and he was in death throes, so I killed him. Now, I don't think that's true, by the way. I think he was probably scavenging the bodies. But there's a lot of debate. Is that true or is that not? I don't think it's true based on 1 Samuel 31. But in any event, this guy's telling the wrong man this because David says, fine, you killed him? He tells him, kill this guy. Now, why kill him? He killed him because he had the audacity to kill the Lord's anointed. That's why the armor bearer wouldn't do it. That's why David, when he had the drop on Saul, who's been trying to kill him, wouldn't do it. He says, if the Lord wants to take him out, the Lord will take him out. But he says, who are you to wind up killing him? Okay, when the Philistines get to Saul's body on Mount Gilboa, they cut his head off. That's why he didn't want him to get him. Cut his head off, strip him of his armor. They hang him on the wall of Bethshan. And the people of Jabesh Gilead, when they hear about this, remember he'd rescued them, they come and they take his body down. All right, because it was a shameful thing to have that out there. Now David composed a lament for Saul and Jonathan. And I'm finished. We'll pick back next week, Lord willing, 2 Samuel 2, where David is anointed at Hebron as king over the house of Judah. Thanks for sticking with me.